The perception that diesel engines run slower and generate a lot of black smoke is long gone. Modern diesel engines have moderate fuel consumption and higher fuel efficiency. Also, they have impressive torque at low speeds. This is great for people who are tired of turbo lag. The dynamics of the modern diesel vehicles are excellent, but at the same time, these engines demand higher quality fuel, and repairing diesel engines can get very expensive. A diesel engine doesn't differ too much from a gasoline engine in terms of overall layout, but there are a few significant differences. Let's take a look. The principal differences between these engines is how the fuel-air mixture is formed, ignited, and burned. A diesel internal combustion engine doesn't have spark plugs, so the ignition of the air-fuel mixture is caused by the compression of air in the cylinder. Unlike the gas engine, air and fuel are supplied separately. It should also be noted that practically no modern diesel engine is complete without turbocharging to improve the unit's performance. A diesel engine, like a gas engine, has a crank rod mechanism, but its compression ratio is significantly higher. Diesel engines are typically constructed with compression ratios in the range of 14 to 1 to 22 to 1. Gasoline engines have a ratio between 8 to 1 and 12 to 1. How does a diesel engine work, and how do you ignite the combustion chamber without any spark plugs? First, the air enters the cylinders. The piston moves to compress the air 16 to 25 times. This causes the air to heat up. The temperature is critical in self-igniting the fuel. The fuel is supplied to the combustion chamber under high pressure. The compressed hot air reacts and ignites, and the explosion forces the piston to move down, which in turn causes the crankshaft to rotate. Then the process repeats. This is how fuel in a diesel engine ignites without spark plugs. It doesn't have a flame that travels. By the pressure, it all ignites at the same time. That's one of the reasons they're more efficient and get better gas mileage. There are plugs in a diesel engine, but they're not spark plugs. They are called glow plugs. What do? Glow plugs heat the air inside the combustion chamber. Imagine the hot wires you see in your toaster. They look similar to that. They're metal or ceramic coils installed in a swirl chamber. When you turn on the ignition, the glow plugs heat up very quickly to 1900 degrees Fahrenheit and heat the air inside the combustion chamber. When the fuel gets injected, and then combustion process begins. Diesel engines got their name from their inventor, Rudolf Diesel, a German engineer who was born in Paris. According to one legend, Rudolf Diesel found inspiration in a cigar lighter. He placed the wick in a glass tube, which heated up slowly as the disc moved, and started compressing the air trapped inside. The inventor soon understood that he compressed the air and added fuel that would result in ignition. At the time of his invention, nobody was producing special fuel for the first diesel engines. Rudolf became interested in using coal dust. The idea sounded good because Rudolf had a German patent and there was plenty of coal in Germany. But coal dust didn't work because of the high abrasives. And there was a bigger problem with the dust going into the cylinders. Rudolf switched to oil instead and caused the pistons to be driven by a flywheel. The new configuration reached 20 horsepower. And the efficiency factor was about 30%. At the time, the results were acceptable because there were no other motors like this available. It was said that the diesel engine could run continuously for more than half a month. At the beginning of the 1900s, licenses to produce diesel engines were being sold to manufacturers of ships, power plants, and water pumps. Total contracts ended up in the millions of dollars. People were realizing diesel engines were four times more economical. They started becoming widely used in transportation, and thus began the demise of the age of stokers who shoveled coal. This time period saw a lot of experiments around compact motors for cars, but numerous tests led to failure. It wasn't until 1924 that the first diesel-powered truck was made in Germany. History of production of diesel cars began in 1933 with Citroën's Rosalie. Shortly after, in 1936, the world saw the Mercedes-Benz 260D. It had a 2-liter engine, produced 45 horsepower, and came with a price tag of 6,800 Reichmarks, which in today's dollars would be more than $95,000. In 1939, a diesel Hanomag Record was introduced. It had an aerodynamic body and reached a maximum speed of 95 miles an hour, which is pretty quick back in 1939. 70 years later, the Germans were still experimenting with diesel engines and getting good results. In 2006, the Audi R10 TDI became the first diesel car to win the 24-hour Le Mans race. The race car was equipped with a 5.5-liter V12 diesel engine with twin turbos. It had an output of 650 horsepower and 1,100 newton meters of torque. There are two types of diesel engines, indirect injection and direct injection diesel engines. The names can be misleading because the difference between the two isn't how fuel is injected, but where it's injected. The two engines have different combustion chamber designs. Indirect injection, or IDI, was more common in the 80s and early 90s, but it's been replaced by the more efficient direct injection. The IDI system has a pre-chamber, also called swirl chamber, above the cylinder. This is where fuel gets injected and rapidly mixes with air. Auto ignition starts there. Fuel enters the combustion chamber rapidly, mixing the fuel with air in the cylinder, and atomization is achieved. The glow plug is also located in the pre-chamber, and the shape of the pistons in an IDI tend to resemble those of a gasoline engine. The IDI has a high rate of swirl over a wide range of speeds, doesn't require as much pressure, and has less of a chance of blockage due to self-cleaning pintle injectors. The IDI, however, has higher fuel consumption due to lower thermal efficiency and a higher compression ratio required to start the engine. The other type of diesel engine is the direct injection, or DI. DI diesel engines inject fuel directly into the combustion chamber right on top of the piston. DI engines operate at higher injection pressures, so these engines don't need a pre-chamber to ensure proper diffusion of fuel into air. Direct injection diesel engines operate at a much higher level of efficiency with significantly lower emissions and greater performance. They're also cheaper to build. That's why most modern automotive diesel engine designs are based on the direct injection system. So which should you choose, diesel or gasoline? Cars that run on gas are more dynamic. They're typically cheaper than diesel cars because gas engines are simpler and cheaper to build compared to diesel engines. Gasoline engines aren't as noisy, and they don't face problems with fuel ignition during winter that you can have with diesel cars. If you were to compare gasoline versus diesel cars can achieve maximum torque at the first few seconds of ignition. Diesel provides more torque than gasoline does. This allows for better acceleration. It's not difficult for a diesel car to get going after idling or from low RPM, but gas cars can stall by comparison. Diesel cars don't have turbo lag, which is useful when you need that power boost to pass the car on the road quickly. Now remember that torque and power are related. They can't have one without each other. They go hand in hand. The higher the torque, the higher the power of the engine. But torque comes into play only where there is resistance. For example, the torque of a tractor that's driven slowly along a road is constantly minimal, but its torque reaches maximum when a tractor tries to overcome an obstacle. That's when torque comes into play to boost power. It's the same idea for gasoline engines. When the road is smooth, gasoline and diesel cars run approximately the same. When going uphill or overcoming an obstacle, diesel engine's torque can increase to its max, so the diesel car is able to push ahead with strength. But what about the gasoline car? When the gas car reaches a higher speed naturally, it can also overcome the obstacle, but not as fast. So the difference is that diesel engine gets more power quicker than a regular gasoline engine can. Another thing to consider is that diesel engines require you to change oil more often. Tests show that diesel cars are very reliable. Many of the engine parts must be made strong and durable to handle high compression, and this in turn makes diesel engines heavier in weight and higher in cost. But over a long period of time, both cars can end up costing roughly the same in similar driving conditions. Wintertime can be a challenge for diesels. When overnight temperatures begin to dip down near 30 degrees Fahrenheit, time to blend in winter diesel with additives for winter. Otherwise, if you're sticking with summer diesel, it'll start getting cloudy, thicken up, and then gel in your gas tank. It's like trying to pump Jell-O through your injectors when that happens. For gas engines, you don't have that problem, so that's a relief. So there are various advantages and disadvantages for both types of engines. Any engine from a good car manufacturer or brand will serve you a long time in general. So when choosing an engine, you want to consider your driving needs and patterns. If your trips are usually in a city or suburbs, gasoline engines are the best way to go. On the other hand, if you're regularly driving long distances or driving up steep hills or elevations or carrying heavy loads, then a diesel engine is the better bet. Diesels are powerful for heavy loads. They're strong for driving on highways and long distance drivings. Even at high speeds, diesels have lower RPM and transmission gears shift less frequently. Because of that, if you need to do long distances on the highway, the diesels are a more efficient choice. gas engine can accelerate faster from 0 to 60, but a diesel can perform better when you're trying to pass another car, and also it can handle heavier loads than a gasoline car. If you need to tow a boat or a trailer, then definitely go for a diesel if you're doing long drives. If you want a fast sports car to drive on the weekends, then a gasoline car is fine. What's the best fuel for your car? Does higher octane mean more energy or more power? If you put premium gas to a car that requires regular gas, will it improve your engine performance or gas mileage? In the U.S., unleaded gasoline usually comes in three grades. Normally, we have 87 for basic or regular, 89 for plus or mid-grade, and 93 for premium. But what is octane rating and what does it mean? Octane rating refers to how resistant the fuel is to combustion by pressure. The higher the octane rating, the more compression the fuel can withstand before it ignites. Higher octane fuels are often required or recommended for engines that use a higher compression ratio and/or use supercharging or turbocharging to force more air into the engine. Increasing pressure in the cylinder allows an engine to extract more mechanical energy from a given air-fuel mixture, but requires higher octane fuel to keep the mixture from pre-detonating. Octane rating does not relate directly to the power output. It has nothing to do with the energy contained per liter or per kilogram of fuel. Fuels with a higher octane rating are used in higher compression engines that potentially yield higher power. But such higher power comes from higher compression of the engine, not necessarily from the gasoline. Do you know why the octane numbers at gas stations in the U.S. differ from those in Europe? Europe has 95 and 99. Does this mean that Europe uses higher octane? No, because in the U.S., gas stations use pump octane number or PON, but Europe uses RON, which means research octane number. It's just a matter of definition. So the American 89 octane, or mid-grade, is the same as the European 95 octane. And the American 93, or premium grade, is the same or similar to the European 99. In 1921, an English engineer, Harry Ricardo, discovered that the more iso-octane in the fuel, the more resistance it was to detonation. He developed a scale to measure detonation resistance. Gasoline made up of 100% iso-octane was given an octane rating of 100. Harry's work ultimately led to the general use of octane ratings. There are a lot of myths about octane, so answer true or false. The different octane levels means different energy content. Different octanes burn fuel hotter or colder or faster or slower. Different octanes burn fuel cleaner and more fully. If you answered yes to any of these myths, then unfortunately you were wrong, because one, the different octane levels all contain the same energy content. Two, they also all burn the same temperature at the same speed. Three, a clean or complete fuel burn depends not on the octane, but mainly on the air to fuel ratio in your car's combustion chamber. So let's break it down. What happens if your car requires high octane gas but you fill it with low octane instead? Nowadays, modern cars have electronic control units, ECUs, that can adjust engine timing and performance to operate even with lower octane fuel. So your car will drive, but engine power and fuel economy will still suffer. Frequent use of fuel with octane lower than what your car needs can lead to poor engine performance and eventually damage both the engine and the emission control system. Here's why. Ignore the ECU for a minute. In general, using lower octane gas in a high octane gas car means that under high pressure, gasoline will ignite spontaneously and earlier than it should. And what is called detonation, that is thermal shock, will occur. This is a spontaneous, uncontrolled ignition of fuel in the engine. Detonation leads to a sharp rise in temperature and even to a possible explosion. Will your engine survive the detonation? And how do you know if or when it's happening? Simple. You hear a knock sound from the engine when a detonation occurs. This knock is created by pressure waves that occur during the rapid combustion of the mixture and get reflected from the walls of the cylinder and piston. This reduces the engine power and accelerates the wear inside. So if detonation waves occur, the engine can be damaged or destroyed. That's how gasoline with a lower octane rating can damage the engine pistons if you regularly use it in a car that requires high octane. What about the opposite scenario? Let's say your car maker requires regular unleaded gas, but you upgrade with mid-grade or premium. Will this affect fuel economy or engine performance? It depends on your driving driving conditions. For example, in most cars, higher octane fuel can improve performance and gas mileage, and it can also reduce carbon dioxide, CO2, emissions during severe duty operation. Like if you're towing a trailer or carrying a heavy load, especially in hot weather. But under normal driving conditions, you'll probably get little to no benefit in fuel economy or engine performance. In that scenario, you have to ask yourself, why pay more for premium gas? So, is there a difference between what your car maker requires versus what they recommend? Yes, there is a difference. In general, if your vehicle requires mid-grade or premium fuel, then higher octane fuel is worth the extra cost. If your owner's manual says your car doesn't require premium fuel, but says that your vehicle will run better on higher octane fuel, in other words, it's recommended but not required, well, then it's really up to you. The cost increase is typically higher than the fuel savings. But some drivers value lower CO2 emissions and lower petroleum usage by even a small amount. And for those drivers, this is more important to them than cost. In conclusion, what fuel should you use for your car? At minimum, use the fuel grade required by the original car manufacturer. Where can you find that information? It's always written in your car manual. If you lost your manual, you can check either the fuel door, because it's usually written there. Or if it's not there, it's probably on the fuel cap. Or if it's not there, check the fuel gauge on your dashboard. Here's a quick cheat sheet on how gasoline works in your car. So you get to the pump, you fuel your car. The gas goes straight to the gas tank. Well, inside the tank is a fuel pump. It pumps the gas into your car's fuel line. The fuel filter filters out debris in the gas. Next, the fuel injector sprays gas into the piston cylinder. The gas gets processed in the engine, typically in a four-stroke cycle. First, air gets sucked into the cylinder. The air and fuel mix as the piston moves downward in the cylinder. As the piston moves back up, it compresses the air and fuel mix. Then the spark plug ignites the compressed air and fuel. This causes a combustion reaction. The liquid gas gets converted into exhaust gas, which forces the piston back down. The exhaust valves open. The exhaust gases leave the cylinder, travel through the exhaust pipe, through the catalytic converter, which reduces the pollutants into less toxic substances like carbon dioxide, nitrogen, and water. And then the gases pass through the muffler and into the air. Then there's gas additives. They can work to increase the octane rating of gas, inhibit corrosion, lubricate, and allow higher compression ratio for greater efficiency and power. However, some additives are harmful and are regulated or banned in some countries. Oftentimes, gas retailers treat the gas they buy with specific additives. Ever hear of top-tier detergent gasoline? In 2004, top-tier gasoline was developed to go beyond the minimum standard for detergent additives to better protect engines from carbon buildup and deposits on the intake valves. Nowadays, engines have become far more precise, operating under tighter tolerances and higher compression ratios with cleaner emissions and improved fuel economy. And that's why many big automakers, Audi, BMW, Fiat Chrysler automobiles, General Motors, Honda, Mercedes-Benz, Toyota, and Volkswagen support top-tier gas. Top-tier fuel must maintain levels of detergent additives that result in a higher standard of engine cleanliness and performance as compared to the EPA minimum requirement. Also, it can't contain metal additives. Let's talk about ethanol. Ethanol is an alternative alcohol fuel. It's made from plant materials like corn and sugar. In fact, did you know that much of the corn grown in the U.S. isn't eaten, popped, or creamed? Some of it is turned into ethanol. It's added to gasoline because it's a cost-effective way to raise the octane rating of gas. Also, ethanol burns cleanly, so it's also a way to help reduce emissions. Ethanol can be burned in a gasoline engine, but it's less than ideal compared to gasoline. Reason is, it has less chemical energy than diesel or regular gasoline. But since ethanol comes from renewable sources, it makes a lot of sense to use as much of it as we can. Ever see the badge for E85? And wonder what that is? E85 is a blend of 85% ethanol and 15% gasoline. It's designed for use in flex fuel vehicles, which can use both gasoline or a mixture of gasoline and ethanol. Well, what happens if you actually put E85 in a non-flex fuel vehicle? Well, your car may run poorly and a check engine light might turn on, but it shouldn't cause major damage to your car. Just be sure to add regular gasoline to the tank when you can to further dilute the ethanol. While 85% ethanol is a bit high use for normal gasoline cars, a more conservative ratio can help stretch gasoline supplies and reduce our reliance on fossil fuels. In fact, that's why at most regular gas stations these days, you might notice a pump with a sticker that says something like, may contain up to 10% ethanol, or a blue pump with a blend of 25%, 30%, or 35% ethanol. These fuels work just fine in most modern cars built after 2002, and that's why we see a bit of ethanol in virtually all gasoline nowadays. You should check your owner's manual or speak to one of the service advisors if you're unsure. By the way, speaking of ethanol and flex fuel cars, did you know that the Ford Model T was the first commercial flex fuel vehicle? The engine of this car was capable of running on both gasoline and ethanol, or a mixture of both. Car engines have lots of moving parts. As these parts move and rub against each other, the force of friction creates heat. Oil lubricates the engine to reduce friction, absorbs heat, and cleans the engine. It does this so that the parts can work effectively together without overheating. But over time, motor oil breaks down and wears out. This makes it less effective in lubricating the engine and absorbing heat. That's why it's very important to change the oil before it breaks down and causes engine damage. There are four main types of motor oil: conventional oil, synthetic blends, and high mileage oil. So which engine oil should you use for your engine and why? Conventional oil is your standard motor oil. It's made from crude oil that's taken from the ground, refined, and processed with additives at a factory. The biggest advantage is it's low cost. It's fairly effective as long as you choose the right weight and quantity. Conventional oil comes in a broad range of viscosities and qualities. It's usually used in cars with simple engines and for drivers with conservative driving styles. Its disadvantage is that it's less refined than the other type of motor oils due to the naturally occurring materials in it. It also offers a lower degree of protection for your engine compared to other oil types. According to a survey by the Automobile Oil Change Association, over 50% of car owners today use synthetic oil or synthetic blends in their cars. Full synthetic oil, also known as synthetic, is, as the name denotes, chemically engineered. So it's generally more consistent, more refined, and overall better for your engine. It lasts longer in time and distance compared to conventional oil and works better in both high and low temperature extremes. But all that comes with a price. Full synthetic motor oil is more expensive than conventional oil. A synthetic blend is a combination of synthetic and organic oil. It provides better protection and performance than conventional oil, and it lasts longer too. Drivers of pickup trucks and SUVs usually prefer this because it offers additional protection from oxidation and cold temperatures for vehicles that carry heavier loads. It also tends to offer better gas mileage than conventional oil, but not as good as full synthetic oil. So it makes sense that synthetic blends stand in the middle ground in terms of cost, generally costing more than conventional oil, but less than full synthetic oil. High mileage oil. Well, the name speaks for itself. It's enhanced with specific additives to minimize oil burn-off and oil leaks, protect engine seals, prevent oil evaporation, and improve performance. For older cars with over 75,000 miles on them, it's recommended that you use high mileage oil. When you're talking about motor oil, it's not just all about the type, but also about the viscosity of the oil. Viscosity measures the fluid's resistance to flow, and it can be low or high. Put simply, it's how thin or thick it is. For example, a thin liquid like water has a low viscosity, whereas a thick liquid like honey has a high viscosity. So how do you know which oil viscosity your engine needs? You can find it in your car owner's manual, which specifies the oil type and viscosity grade that your car needs. Often you can even find it on the oil cap under the hood. When choosing motor oil, you can see its viscosity by reading a bottle or can. Usually you'll see multiple numbers and letters. The letter W stands for winter. You'll see a number before the letter W, another number after the letter W. The number before the W is the winter oil viscosity parameter. It indicates how well the oil flows at 0 degrees Fahrenheit. That's important because let's say you live in a cold climate. Normally, oil thickens up as the weather cools. So in that climate, your car needs thin motor oil so it can flow more easily in your engine. In other words, if your oil is too thick, it'll be harder to start your engine and it can reduce your gas mileage. But let's say you live in a hot climate. Ever notice how oil in a pan thins out as the pan heats up? Hot temperature thins out oil. So if you live in a hot climate, your car needs oil that doesn't become too thin. In other words, a motor oil with a higher viscosity or a higher number before the letter W, like 10W. Then there's the number after the letter W. That's the summer oil viscosity parameter based on viscosity at 212 degrees Fahrenheit. This is the oil's ability to resist thinning out at higher temperatures. For example, 10W30 oil thins out at higher temperature faster than 10W40. So let's talk about motor oil standards. There's a group called ILSAC. They set the performance standards for motor oil used in gas-powered cars and light trucks. Well, they approved GF6, which is the new standard for motor oil, designed to improve fuel economy and enhance engine capabilities. And it went into effect last year. The new standard allows thinner oils to reduce friction and increase fuel economy. This means better protection against wear in a stop-start equipped engine, better protection of timing chains, and protection against low-speed pre-ignition. LSPI is actually a problem that can happen in modern turbos when the fuel ignites too soon, which is bad because the explosion can damage your engine. So preventing LSPI helps car makers to tune the engine for greater efficiency. GF6A is for existing cars. It covers the current APISN oil viscosities of 0W20, 5W20, 5W30, and 10W30. It meets all specifications for these current oils, in addition to meeting the latest GF6 specifications. It's backwards compatible, meaning it offers some of the new standards benefits, but it works fine in cars designed for the older standards. That said, even though it's backwards compatible, GF6A is really not intended for engines older than maybe the latest generation of production engines, or roughly back to the mid-1990s. GF6B is the new standard only for 0W16 low viscosity oil, and it's not backwards compatible. GF6B standard is mainly aimed at turbocharged gasoline direct injected engines tasked with achieving fuel economy levels, and it's aimed at engines that were made in 2017 and newer. So how do you know if your motor oil is GF6 approved? Well, oils that meet GF6A standard show the Starburst APA mark on the container. Oils that meet the GF6B standard display the new API shield. Now let's talk about oil changes. So how frequently should you change your oil? That depends on many factors. For example, vehicle age, oil type, the way you drive, even where you live. It used to be normal to change the oil every 3,000 miles. But with modern lubricants, many engines nowadays have recommended change intervals of 5,000 to 7,000 miles. For many cars, that should be fine. But you might want to consider changing your oil more often if you tend to drive at high speed. It's also true if you have an older engine or live in an area that's particularly hot, cold, or dusty. If your engine requires full synthetic, then it could even go as far as 15,000 miles. Of course, it's always important to follow your car owner's manual from the manufacturer's recommendation. So how do you know if or when your engine is in need of an oil change? There are several common signs. The most obvious warning is you're having an oil problem that will come from the car itself. Newer cars come equipped with an oil monitoring system. The oil change indicator, or the check engine light on your dashboard, will turn on when there's not enough oil in the system. In that case, you can check your engine's dipstick. Another warning is increased engine noise. When your car is sufficient motor oil, the oil helps protect the engine parts. That means the engine stays quiet since the oil is lubricating all the metals. But let's say your oil level is low. This means there's not much to lubricate the engine parts, so the parts will brush against each other, and the result is you may hear knocking or rumbling sounds. That's never a good thing, because basically your engine is tearing itself apart bit by bit. If you sense an oil smell inside your car, it could mean you have an oil leak. If you also smell gas or exhaust fumes, your car might be overheating. Either way, you should take it to the shop to get it checked out as soon as possible. If you see the exhaust smoke coming out of your tailpipe, that's time for an engine checkup too. Your car might have an oil leak or some other malfunctioning engine parts. If you have excessively high mileage in a particular month, you should consider changing your oil a bit sooner than your normal schedule. Check your owner's manual for specific guidelines. But now let's shift gears and debunk some common myths about motor oil. True or false? Black oil must always be changed. Actually, that's false. Motor oil darkens, especially when the oil is exposed to high engine temperatures, and therefore oxidizes. It can also darken as it absorbs byproducts from combustion. Dark color itself doesn't mean the oil is dirty or no longer doing its job. Instead, what you should watch out for is how dirty the oil is. If the oil is gritty or grainy, then yeah, get it changed as soon as possible. A common myth is that you need thicker motor oil for extra wear protection, but that's false too. Thicker motor oil can be better for older engines with parts that have worn down over the years. But let's say you have a newer car. If you use oil that's thicker than recommended for the engine, it can actually decrease engine efficiency. Many modern cars actually recommend lower viscosity for better fuel economy. So it's best to use the viscosity weight recommended by the engine manufacturer, because the manufacturer knows their product the best. They know how best to protect the moving parts based on the design and surface roughness. Many people think that all oil additives are the same. False again. Engineers develop different additives to help engines in different ways. For example, some additives help the oil to perform better under high pressure and heavy use, like in racing engines. Others help older high mileage cars last longer by preserving seals. The point is, different additives are for different purposes, so it's not one size fits all. Another myth about additives is that they improve engine performance. For sure, additives help engines, but they can't add horsepower to your engine or improve gas mileage. Do synthetics cause oil leaks? When synthetics first came out in the 70s, they caused wear and tear to seals and gaskets. Today, that's not the case. Modern synthetics have come a long way, and in fact, they do a better job than conventional oil in protecting engine parts, especially at extreme temperatures. Some people say once you go synthetic, you can't go back. That's not true either. Actually, it's fairly common for people to switch. If you changed the filter last time, do you need to change it again this time? Oil filters are important because they remove a lot of the dirt, grime, and sludge from your engine. But the filter's performance degrades over time as it removes more and more contaminants. Oil filters are usually designed to last one oil cycle. So yes, you should change your filter every time you change the oil. Well, there you have it. They say prevention is always cheaper than a cure, and it's true. A regular oil change is a small maintenance job, but it makes a huge impact in keeping your engine in good condition. If you enjoyed this episode, please subscribe to my channel for more car technology and history videos. Thanks for your support.